Hello, thanks for joining us on your channel of choice at this time, Africa Independent Television. Welcome to Focus Nigeria, your program that puts the searchlight on topical issues in the polity. My name is Benga Arileba. I most warmly welcome you to the midweek edition of the program today. Now, when the then president, Dr. Goodluck Ebele Jonathan, signed the new Administration of Criminal Justice Bill into law on May 14, 2015, barely 3 weeks to the end of his tenure, it was widely believed that even though the regime was outgoing, it had nonetheless laid the foundation for a radical improvement in the criminal justice sector in Nigeria, a key demand of justice sector stakeholders for so many years. As succinctly captured in his opening paragraphs, the Administration of Criminal Justice Act 2015 has a key broad objective of promoting efficient management of criminal justice institutions, ensuring speedy dispensation of justice, ensuring the protection of the rights and interests of all actors in the Nigerian criminal justice system. The very comprehensive law, divided into 48 parts and 495 sectors, covered all the field as far as the criminal justice system is concerned, from arrest to investigation, trial, custodial, and sentencing. What is more, the law also has provisions on pre- and post-trial remedies to ensure that the system is not only efficient and transparent, but more accountable. Even though this law has been in operation now since May 2015, there are challenges which are making the desired objectives and goals mere wishes. Professor Yemi Akinseye George has played a very key role in the conception and the eventual birth of this law, and so very conversant with all the issues. He will be joining me shortly for today's conversation as we look at the Administration of Criminal Justice Act, the challenges, and how to surmount all of them. But before that, let's quickly update you on developments trending in the polity at the moment. Now, if you live in Abuja and you pass through the Abuja airport route regularly, you must, of course, have seen the Abuja Centenary City. You can't miss it. If you are on your way to the airport, it will be to your left. And if you are coming from the airport to town, it will be on your right. This was a project launched with so much fanfare by then President Goodluck Jonathan, conceived as a city within a city with everything you can think of. The Centenary City is located on a large expanse of land, about 1,200 hectares of land, really, appropriated by the combined authorities of the president and then Minister of the FCT, Bala Muhammad, from their original owners, including estate developers, some of whom have actually started work. At that time, the impression the government gave us through the then secretary to the government of the Federation, who was the face of the Centenary City, Senator Ayim Pius Ayim, was that this was a government project, you know, belonging to you and I. But today, the story is changing. And a lot is being revealed about what appears to be acts of abuse of public trust and a big centenary scam. Even as it has come to light that the Centenary City is not a federal government project, not at all, but rather is a project belonging to two different private companies, the owners of whom, well, are they workers or they've been traced to Senator Ayim Pius Ayim? Last week, Senator Ayim appeared before the House of Representatives Committee on the FCT, which is investigating petitions by aggrieved owners of the land, who are angry that some government officials at that time had used their official positions and government machinery to deprive them of their entitlement. But the appearance of Senator Ayim last Friday ended on a fiasco as he engaged in a dogfight with the committee chairman, Honorable Herman Himbe, whom he accused of bias. Now, yesterday, it was the turn of another official of the Centenary, or the companies accused of being owners of the Centenary City, the company secretary, who also appeared before the committee. And boy, boy, oh boy, it was not funny at all. But could it be that what the officials of the Centenary City are doing is a deliberate rehearsed action to draw out the committee members, provoke them sufficiently, and make them lose focus of the real issues here? Okay, try and find out yourself as we give you the two scenarios. Last Friday, when Senator Anyim appeared, and then yesterday, when the company secretary, that's the company secretary of the Centenary City Company, also appeared before them, but in his own case, he didn't succeed in bamboozling the members. He was walked out. Here we go.
That when the former DG of Securities and Exchange Commission accused you of demanding bribe from her, you pushed for her to be sacked, and I refused to sack her while I was SGF. And so this is an opportunity for you to pay me back. Mr. Chairman, I will not allow you to use the National Assembly platform to pursue personal vendetta. It is unacceptable, and I will not submit to it because it offends the rule of fair hearing, and all I'm asking for is fair hearing. Two, Mr. Chairman, you have been threatening to conduct this public hearing for over a year now. In fact, you ended last year with it. You ended last year with it, and this year you started again with it. You scheduled it for 27th of January. You moved it to 1st of February. You now moved it eventually to 3rd of February. Mr. Chairman, we only discovered your game plan for all the postponement when you started sending messages to the managing director to come and see you privately. It was after all your efforts to get the managing director to come and see you privately failed. Can you confirm this date? I want you to know that nobody will see you privately, and we are here for the hearing.
Good.
And we have the hearing. I am convinced that Mr. Chairman has a deep-seated personal interest and bias in this matter. And so he is not in a position to guarantee fair hearing to myself, to the Centenary City Management, and indeed to the entire subject matter. I accordingly demand that Mr. Chairman should disqualify himself and let the Vice Chairman take over and let us continue. So, Mr. Chairman, you can hand over to your vice and excuse us to continue. So you should be able to disqualify yourself. Otherwise, there is no reason anybody will submit himself to a system and to an arrangement that does not guarantee fair hearing. So we are here for the hearing. We are ready for the hearing. But we should get fair hearing.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. No, there's not. This is. We shouldn't subject this to a debate. Mr. Former Senate President, Senator Dr. Pius Anyim, we invited you here for the public hearing. Like I said at one forum, and I remember it categorically, if I have sent messages, messages are beautiful things. They are usually on phones. You cannot, they remain there. Such a person is free to bring those kind of documents forward and say, this is how Honorable Himbe has contacted me or whatever. That's, which I'm just saying, that is childish. My bottom line is this. Thank you for your contribution. We had excused you at the beginning of this program. The excuse is still open. If you want to take the option of excuse as a former presiding officer of the Senate, on the strength of that, my ruling here is that I am going to preside over this public hearing, and this public hearing will continue. Yes. I so rule. It is curious that the Honorable Secretary of Government of Federation told Mr. President that the entire city was going to be completely private owned. What was his business now, ask me CFO? When the Centenary City had already come on board.
We have excuse me. No, you cannot deny this, Mr.
Hold
Chairman.
On, please.
You asked me for the authority why I
have
gave
I have
CFO, and I have given you.
I have received the
and you are invalidating it. Yeah. It's not fair.
So you signed this agreement knowing that you, the Honorable Minister, the representative of the President, were going to break this with the law?
Go into a long discourse. What I said is the land of FCT are timeline in terms of development. If we go by that template, all the land in FCT will be revoked.
Why then do you set laws if you don't keep them? May keep the laws.
But I said it's administrative. This
is not
the parliamentary.
When we submit this document to the relevant...
I exercise my power as a minister not
hold us
to revoke it. And I have no apology.
It does appear from what the former minister said that there's a letter from chief of staff. What I brought has not brought any letter from chief of staff. And I've been able to go through the presidium by the man from NEBSA, which is not coming up. He mentioned that there's a flow of process and documentation where the president formally approved that it should become a NEPSA program. I'm asking Mr. Chairman, sir, to direct the SCT minister and his people to hand over the full file of communication on this transaction of the Centenary City, so that this committee is well briefed and apprised and take a decision that nobody can stand up to and say, if you are considering my document or my information, you won't have had this decision.
April of 2011, my company got an allocation of land, number 5 in Babishi District, signed by the then Minister of FCT, Senator Bala Mohammed. We went into pre-development process. I personally paid 140 million naira premium for the COO. When we came back from Christmas vacation, January of 2013, I went there for site supervision, and the security man on the site handed me a paper, you know, once for all, that our property had been taken over by Centenary City. Initially, we thought it's a government project. But when we appointed lawyers and investigators and realized that it was a private sector-driven enterprise, just like any of us, honestly speaking, people wanted to riot. But as a father, I called 75 of us together. I said, listen, we cannot destroy because we are builders. Builders do not destroy, but because we have to march forward and get a peaceful settlement to this.
You will not teach us a process. I'm a lawyer too. And I know how objections happen because don't argue with me.
If you can hear me outside.
Sergeant Adams, could you put out the microphone?
The chairman will object to your continuing presiding over the affairs of this committee.
We have noted your objection.
Against you. We have written a letter to the Honorable Speaker detailing allegations against you as a presiding over.
Sergeant at Arms will escort the gentleman out.
So why
Sergeant Arms, Sergeant, hold on, hold on. Sergeant, I want to rule on that. I said the Sergeant at Arms will rule the gentleman out.
We have never raised any objection to any of those agencies.
Serious Nigerians are here thinking about
traffic. Who are you to come and dictate to us here?
Rubbish.
Like my worry friend will say, shoo, shoo Peru, nawa, nariwa, Nigeria. One day, one problem. I guess that word is just festering. It has not even started. These are just preliminary issues. The real details of this Centenary City has not even come out yet. Again, I say, nawa, nariwa. Anyway, let's get set for our discussion. Oh, I almost forgot this. Now, this is a kind of breaking news, and I guess this will settle all the issues. The Senate has confirmed receiving the nomination of Justice Walter Nkanu. No, okay, Justice Walter Onogen as the substantive Chief Justice of Nigeria. His name has been forwarded to the Senate by the acting president, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, and it has been confirmed by the office of the Senate president. I guess, like I said, that settles it. Whoever has any further politics to play on the nomination of Justice Walter Onogen as the next Chief Justice of Nigeria should go to the Senate where the hearing starts, or otherwise forever remain silent. Okay? I'll be back shortly, and we'll be reviewing the operations of the Administration of Criminal Justice Act 2015. Signed into law on May 14 or so, 2015, by then President Goodluck Jonathan. Challenges of implementing this new law is what we'll be looking at when Professor Yemi Akinseye George joins me shortly.
That you have told everybody that cares to listen, that when the former DG of Securities and Exchange Commission accused you of demanding bribe from her, you pushed for her to be sacked, and I refused to sack her while I was SGF. And so this is an opportunity for you to pay me back. Mr. Chairman, I will not allow you to use the National Assembly platform to pursue personal vendetta. It is unacceptable. and I will not submit to it because it offends the rule of fair hearing, and all I'm asking for is fair hearing. Two, Mr. Chairman, you have been threatening to conduct this public hearing for over a year now. In fact, you ended last year with it. You ended last year with it, and this year you started again with it. You scheduled it for 27th of January. You moved it to 1st of February. You now moved it eventually to 3rd of February. Mr. Chairman, we only discovered your game plan for all the postponement when you started sending messages to the managing director to come and see you privately. It was after all your efforts to get the managing director to come and see you privately failed. Can you confirm this date? I want you to know that nobody will see you privately, and we are here for the hearing.
Good.
And we have the hearing. I am convinced that Mr. Chairman has a deep-seated personal interest and bias in this matter. And so he is not in a position to guarantee fair hearing to myself, to the Centenary City Management, and indeed to the entire subject matter. I accordingly demand that Mr. Chairman should disqualify himself and let the Vice Chairman take over and let us continue. So, Mr. Chairman, you can hand over to your vice and excuse us to continue. So you should be able to disqualify yourself. Otherwise, there is no reason anybody will submit himself to a system and to an arrangement that does not guarantee fair hearing. So we are here for the hearing. We are ready for the hearing, but we should get fair hearing.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. No, there's not. This is. We shouldn't subject this to a debate. Mr. Former Senate President, Senator Dr. Pius Anyim.
Okay, if you're just joining us, our guest is here now, so let's start the discussions. Professor Yemi Akinseye George is a senior advocate of Nigeria. More than that, is the President Center for Social Legal Studies, CSLS. What else do I add? Legal practitioner, of course, you are a senior advocate.
That's right.
So that's in fact.
That's right.
Leonard Sick, good to see you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Good to see you. Yeah. Maybe we should start on a very good news.
Yes.
I don't know whether you are aware. The Senate has just confirmed that it has received from the acting president the name of Justice Walter Onnoghen for screening and confirmation as the next Chief Justice of Nigeria. I guess that would douse all the tension.
Absolutely.
Whoever has any politics to play on the nomination, whether it should be or it should not be,
should go to the Senate.
Where the hearing will take place should be there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think it's a step in the right direction. And I do not see any reason why the Senate should delay the confirmation. Particularly because, Onnoghen is, he's a very brilliant judge. Apart from being a brilliant judge, you know, he has consistently demonstrated that justice must serve the needs of the country. You know, a good example is his decision in Saraki and FRN, where he made it clear that interlocutory applications should no longer, you know, be a reason, should no longer be allowed as
to
a means
delay
of delaying criminal proceedings. Let people have their day in court. If they are not guilty, the court will say so. And if they have, you know, things to explain, the court will say so. So why do we want to delay and postpone criminal trials endlessly? You know, and that damages the integrity of our criminal justice system. You know, and it's an encouragement to criminality when criminal trials and are not concluded, especially when we have the defendants being a high-profile or politically exposed persons.
Long before now, he was one of the three justices of the Supreme Court that found courage to still rule in favor of then candidate General Ibrahim.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Buhari,
in his petition against Goodluck
Jonathan. That also shows courage of his conviction. He has a man who has the courage of his conviction. You know, judges don't always agree on everything. But often, many don't express their dissent.
That's true.
They rather join the majority. But a few muster the courage.
Particularly, you are not the one that will write the judgment.
Precisely. A few muster the courage and express their own independent opinion. You know, and that independent opinion may be the law in the nearest future. You know, so it is important that people should be conscious of legacy. They should be conscious of the fact that history takes account of the things we do today.
Now this delay, the tardiness on the part of the president to forward his name has brought out one key issue that most people are not looking at. most of your colleague lawyers have argued that in the process of appointing the Chief Justice of Nigeria, the president plays no role, is just a mere conduit. But this delay would probably seem to say, no, that's not the intention of the lawmaker. Because he receives recommendation from the NJC. And if you look at the legal meaning of, and I'm not the ordinary dictionary meaning of recommendation, recommendation could just be advice. So the NJC advises the president that this is the person we think is suitable. Is the president just bound to just take that advice without subjecting it to his own scrutiny? Because that would appear to be what he has done. Because during the week, there were clarifications from the presidency that all the president had been trying to do all this while is that the Supreme Court in the present day is not the Supreme Court that used to be. Don't forget the allegations against the judiciary and all of that, two Supreme Court justices, colleagues of honor again, arrested and all of that. That the president was just trying to be sure that he has not been tainted in any way, and that he wants to be sure that whoever is putting forward as the head of that judiciary is somebody who's blameless.
Yes, I think the delay, as far as I'm concerned, has also brought out some strengths and weaknesses of our constitution. Mm. You know, it shows that the executive, you know, should look at whoever is recommended by the NJC. It also shows that NJC making recommendation should be sure that they do due diligence. Yeah. These things are not for fun.
Yeah.
Checks and balances are put in the constitution to ensure that, you know, damage is not done when it can be prevented.
Mm.
You know, so I think what has happened shows that the president has a role to play, the NJC has a role to play, and everybody, the Senate as well. So
yeah,
if,
because it is at the Senate that you and I can then go and contribute
to the process. If the safety valve has failed at the level of the NJC,
yeah.
If it fails at the level of the executive, there's one more level. Yeah. That's at the level of the legislature.
Yeah.
So these things are deliberately put in the constitution to ensure that the best individuals occupy these very important positions. Yes. Mm.
In view of all of this, we are still part of lessons we're learning from it. Would you suggest that the Senate should also make its process comprehensive? We see how just ordinary judges, not even at the apex level, at the very topmost level of their judiciary, we see how ordinary judges, circuit judges and all of that, how the system subjects them to rigorous clearance process.
I agree with you.
The process of clearing him in the Senate should be open.
The Senate should be
so whoever has politics to play should go there and do it.
The process should be open.
Yeah.
The process should be open. The Senate should be thorough.
Mm.
The office of the Chief Justice of Nigeria is too important to be left to
bow and go.
Precisely. Let's find out. Is there any reason? Is there anything that the public need to know about this candidate? You know. But as far as we are concerned in the legal profession, as far as we can see, Onoghen has proved himself as a good judge, you know, going by the records. But of course, you don't know, there may be information that we members of the public don't have. So the Senate should find out before confirming the nomination.
All right, thank you so much, Prof, for at least voluntary opinion on that.
Yes.
Let's get to the business of why we invited you here. The Administration of Criminal Justice Act 2015. I had said before you got here that you were one of those people who midwived.
Absolutely. This absolutely.
Law.
Thank you.
And so, if that child is not growing fast now, if a child of
almost two years,
should be crawling by now.
Absolutely.
So, if this child is still sucking breaths, and is not showing signs that he wants to crawl, not to talk of even trying to take the first step, then something is wrong.
That's right.
Is there something wrong with this law?
The law is good, as far as I'm concerned. There can be no perfect law.
Mm.
But when individuals who ought to give life, who ought to breathe life into that law, fail to do so, the law cannot activate itself. The provisions have been made, but there are people who should do certain things to make the law work very well. I'll give you an illustration.
Okay, sir.
Provision for witness protection, payment of witness expenses. Mm.
Provision of
witness protection, witness expenses, then support for prosecutors.
Yeah.
You know, support for prosecutors, you know, to ensure that the witnesses are available, to ensure that they're able to investigate their cases and get their witnesses before the court.
Mm.
You know, if this support is not provided, if funds is not allocated to activate these provisions of the law is not going to enforce itself. We were making a point a few days ago that this law having been made, the authorities, the executive, the executive particularly, has to look into this law and bring out those provisions that are needed to give life to the law. And this has not been done. This has to be done as a matter of urgency.
That is one key challenge that you have seen.
Absolutely.
Okay. But maybe from the layman's point of view, yes. Let me probably go to what I have tried to itemize reading this law. By the way, this is one of the most comprehensive laws I've ever seen.
Thank you.
48 parts.
That's right.
About 495 sections.
Yes.
That's very comprehensive.
Yes.
Is that a challenge or is it because I had to read this law, leave it at a point, mark where I stop, then resume again at another point and all of that. Is that one of the challenges? That this law is too comprehensive, and like they say, if you want the Nigerian not to know something, just put it in a book. You know he will never find it.
The law is not perfect, but it covers the ground, covers the field. Most of the challenges, because when it was being developed, we deliberately attempted to respond to the challenges that we have been experiencing in the criminal justice system. Challenges of delay, problems with remand proceedings, holding charge, delay of trial, adjournment of cases, and so on. Transfer of judges. Mm. All of this, there was a deliberate attempt by the various technical committees, some of which we coordinated to address these challenges. Mm. And we believe that so much has been put into that law. Mm. And a few days ago, we called together, we had an event, a night of recognitions, whereby we isolated for appreciation some individuals who also contributed immensely to the development of this law. That was necessary because we should not forget the sacrifice. We should not forget the efforts, the industry that went into the process and that produced this law. But there are still, already we have observed that there are aspects of the law that, may require some amendment. But even before the amendment is done,
yeah.
There are enough provisions in this law to tackle most of the challenges facing the criminal justice system.
Hmm. No doubt, like you have just explained now, it's deliberate effort to make it cover defeat.
Yes, there was a deliberate effort. Yes.
Isn't the same deliberate effort also required on the part of the stakeholders to understand it?
Absolutely.
Lawyers,
absolutely.
Other stakeholders.
Absolutely.
Have you seen that demonstrated in the last?
That has started. Various organizations, our organization, for instance, we've just concluded a series of meetings, interactive meetings with all the anti-corruption agencies. Ministry of Justice, we've been having interaction with them. Mm. And I know organizations like Justice for All, Legal Defense and Assistance Project, have been building capacity in collaboration. In fact, as we speak, there's a capacity building program going on in the Ministry of Justice. In fact, I'll be going there as soon as I leave here. It's a collaboration between the Administration of Criminal Justice Monitoring Committee, Justice for All, and the Federal Ministry of Justice. Mm. That is ongoing. So there's need to create more understanding, more awareness. Mm. There's so much in the law, as rightly said, it's a bulky law. Runs into almost 500 sections, written in fairly technical, not too technical, but fairly technical language.
Okay.
There's need to create greater understanding of the law by not just by lawyers, but also by even non-lawyers, litigants, court users, so that they can say, I think I read something like this in the law. Why is it not being done? Victims, complainants, and so on and so forth. So there's need to do a lot of capacity building so that so many individuals can demand compliance where the law is not being adequately
Because I doubt applied. How many members of the public, there may also be lawyers that may not even be aware.
Even lawyers.
If you are defending a suspect, for instance, who has not been charged to court, has just merely been arrested by the police.
Yes.
And that when the police is taking his statement, that the requirement of the law is that entire process should be videotaped.
Absolutely. And if it's not videotaped, it must be witnessed.
Exactly.
By either a legal practitioner.
Defending the suspect.
A legal practitioner of the defendant.
Sorry, that's another.
In fact, we no longer use the word accused person.
I'll come back to that too.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I'm glad you have been reading the law. That's great. Anyway, you have a duty to inform the public, so you must be knowledgeable. Precisely. I'm delighted you are reading it.
Thank you, Prof.
Yes, I'm delighted. Yes.
Now, let. Still talking about understanding this law, I noticed that before this law came into being in 2015,
yes.
Lagos State had probably pioneered that effort.
Yes.
they came up with an administration of criminal justice
law.
In 2007, I think it was the brainchild of acting president Yemi Akinseye
George
as Attorney General of Lagos
State.
And since then, the Lagos State judiciary has not been the same.
It has
been on a higher pedestal than any other state in the federation.
In fact, as far as justice sector is concerned,
Lagos State is the
prime example.
Yes.
Lagos is the foremost champion of reform, you know, in the justice sector. Perhaps in some other sectors. But since 1999 to 2007, when Professor Yemi Akinseye was the Attorney General of the state, certain fundamental reforms were implemented in Lagos.
Extreme makeover, if you ask me.
You know, and
I started covering the judiciary from Lagos State.
Absolutely.
And I know what the magistrate court used
was
to
our
be like.
Hope. That was our hope. Because if the justice system is not right, it cannot be right with the economic system. If the system of enforcing, ensuring the law, particularly the rule of law, if those systems are not put in place, we call them intangible infrastructure. You are building roads, you are building houses, you are building railway and all of that. And you don't have a proper system of law maintenance. You don't have a proper system of law enforcement. You are wasting your time. As Yorubas will say, only omoti the same thing goes for the criminal justice,
which means the child that you refuse
to train
will
turn around and waste the assets that you invested the money
that
on.
You were busy acquiring.
So the criminal justice system is at the heart of development. It's at the heart of democracy. We need more adequate attention paid to that sector. Not just from the point of view of improving the welfare of judges, you know, ensuring that judges have independence, but also ensuring that prosecutors, investigators, all of this go together.
Yeah.
If the judges are well taken care of, I learned that there's going to be an increase in the allocation to judiciary. What about the prosecutors? What about
the
investigators?
This year's budget.
Now, complainants who go to the police station have to fund investigation of cases. What about poor complainants? That means they have no chances of being heard. Can we not be sensible enough to make provision for investigation of offenses? Look at criminality all over the system. The reason why there's a high wave of criminality is because the criminal justice system is not efficient to demand correct behavior. Even when people misbehave, most times this is not reported because a lot of people do not have confidence in the justice system. That explains the very low population of our prison relative to the level of criminality in the society.
Yeah. You know, so I've been trying to understand that system until I struck that point. There could be loss of faith in the system. Because you say there's so much crime committed on a daily basis in Nigeria.
A lot of crimes are committed.
But the prison population doesn't. You think that Nigeria is El Dorado.
Nigeria's criminal justice system lock up people who have not been tried. So there are powerful people who just pick individuals for one reason or the other and just lock them up. I remember an employer who decided to instigate criminal proceedings against a former employee for daring to leave his employment. And that fellow spent close to 6 years in prison.
For just
simply because he left an employment that was not, you know, productive, that was not meeting his needs. You know, so the criminal justice system has been neglected for too long. So we had high hopes when His Excellency Professor Akinseye became the vice president. Unfortunately, it appears that efforts have been made, but we are not seeing the results.
Well, probably one issue is being addressed now, the issue of funding. We'll come back to that.
And if this,
I know that this year's budget for the judiciary has gone up significantly.
Yes, but that's not sufficient.
Before, what we had was a decline. From 1999, it was just going down and going down and going
down.
Whereas that of the other two arms, executive and legislature, were going up.
That's a step in the right direction.
Yeah.
That's highly commendable. However, what about investigators? What about prosecutors? Even if the judges are doing very well and the witnesses are not there, how do they get the cases tried? That's why when people keep blaming the courts, I say you need to equip all the segments because the criminal justice, that's why we call it a system. You need the investigators, you need the prosecutors, you even need the public to be vigilant, to report criminality, and to be sure that when they report crimes, they will not be turned into the criminals themselves.
Yeah.
Because the public now are very reluctant to report criminal behavior.
Yeah.
That is why people are very reluctant to give information. And there's nowhere in the world where law enforcement is done by law enforcement agents alone. Every member of the public has a role to play. So we need to be able to restore public confidence in the justice system. If this is the main thing this administration can achieve, it will be reflected in the on the economy. Yeah. It will be reflected on the political system. Look at the electoral crimes, election-related offences. People keep on doing these things because they know that there's provision for accountability.
Yeah.
Governors and people who occupy high positions use their power to abuse the electoral system. Mm. They say they have immunity under the Constitution. So immunity should not be extended to electoral offences. These are some of the things we need to. For another area is the area of constitutional reform. This law is very good, but there are some aspects that require constitutional reform to complement the reform that has been done in the criminal justice system.
Yeah.
The executive has to show more commitment. We have to show interest. Work with the legislature. But at the moment, the legislative reform process, constitutional reform process, is going on quietly, secretly.
Yeah,
I know that.
And this is about the people.
Precisely. When the whole process is concluded now, somebody
will not tell us this is what we have done.
You know?
And then you discover it has not met our yearnings in any way.
So these are the things we have to prioritize. Of course, it's good to prioritize the economy, create jobs. Government has been doing a lot in that respect. But what about the fundamental?
The intangible
infrastructure. What are we doing about it? Justice, rule of law. Justice, rule of law, and the social cultural milieu that sustain economies, infrastructures all over the world.
I raised the issue of Lagos State that time. Actually, where I was going is the fact that there are two other states also that have also joined Lagos State in passing their own administration of criminal justice.
Yes.
Ekiti
has passed it, yes.
Where Wale Fakponda was Attorney General.
Absolutely.
Tried to replicate it in Ekiti.
Which is why we gave Wale Fakponda an award also.
Oh, he got an award.
During the last exercise. Because he demonstrated that occupying political office is not just for fun. Go there and register, make a legacy. Leave an indelible mark. I'm very proud of the legacy we left in the Ministry of Justice. I work with Chief Akinlujimi. I work with Chief Bayojo. There are concrete things that we left behind.
Yeah.
Legal aid reform, reform of administrative criminal justice, arbitration, so many things. Mm. But some of the guys that came after us just thought that it was all about something else, you know. But that's why we thought that we should recognize that those currently in office can know that when they leave, we will write their story too.
Yeah.
We will write their story. You and then don't turn around to say that you are being criticized unfairly. You have an opportunity while you're in office to do the right thing. Mm. Make a mark, leave a legacy. Okay. If everybody does that, Nigeria will not be the way it is now.
Yeah, Ekiti has its own.
Yes.
You said Ondo too.
Ondo has it.
I know Anambra.
Anambra has it. Oyo State has it.
Okay. So now.
Rivers, I think Rivers also has a draft. Kaduna has a draft.
Rivers also has a history of lashing on to sunshine laws at the federal level.
Yes.
Because I remember Rivers was also the first to lash on to the... What was that law then? Not procurement. Fiscal responsibility.
Fiscal responsibility.
Yeah.
Yes.
River State was the first.
Yes. I'm happy you are monitoring the legal system, very closely.
I am.
Yes.
The point I wanted to make, which I'd like you to respond to, is this Administration of Criminal Justice Act will seem to be of federal application alone, in which case it can only apply at the Federal High Courts and the FCT.
I beg to differ.
Okay. That's the impression I got.
You see, Nigeria, criminal justice system.
But you said it's not. So
our criminal justice system is a unified justice system. Okay. Although we have a federal constitution. But that federal constitution deliberately establishes a unitary legal system. Unitary legal system in the sense that we have a common court of appeal for the entire country. A common Supreme Court for the entire country. Mm. We have a common Federal High Court for the whole country. Then we have a common police for the whole country. We have a common prison system for the whole country. Mm. So to that extent, the Administration of Criminal Justice Act applies to all federal institutions.
Okay.
The police, and the police is all over the country. Yeah. So when federal laws are being applied around the country, like the Armed Forces Act, for example, the police has to apply the Administration of Criminal Justice Act. And then it does not matter whether the state has passed this law or not. When it comes to matters touching on the police, this is the law that binds the police, particularly when they're applying federal laws.
Yeah.
But we recognize that in some state courts, we continue to have criminal procedure laws of those states in application. There's no doubt about that. But this law applies all over the country to the activities of the police. How detention of person arrest and detention are managed,
yeah.
how imprisonment is managed, you know, how information is collected about criminal activities
yeah.
and remitted to the Central Criminal Records Registry, which is anticipated in this law. All of this apply generally all over the country.
Mm.
And I was listening to a presentation by a Court of Appeal justice recently, where a lawyer was trying to argue that the Anti-Criminal Criminal Justice Act was not applicable. The Court of Appeal said, we are a federal court, and this law applies to federal courts. So
That's where I'm going.
Absolutely, yeah.
Suppose we go back to where it starts from.
Yes.
Maybe from magistrate, for instance.
Yes.
The magistrate is a state court.
Yes.
The High Court of a state is a state court.
Yes.
The police is a federal institution.
Yes.
Suppose the police wants to prosecute a case at the Court of Appeal. At the Magistrate Court of a state.
Yes.
Or if it's a case that has to start at the High Court, and the police takes the case to a state High Court, can the police prosecutor rely on the federal law that this act is?
They can.
If that state doesn't have its own administration of criminal justice.
That is,
law.
If they are applying, if the law being enforced by the police
yes.
is a federal law. Just like the FCC.
That is, if the charge is brought under a federal law.
Like the FCC prosecutes in Lagos High Court. Of course, Lagos is different because they have an institutional criminal justice law.
Yeah.
But criminal procedure in state high courts, is governed by the laws of the state. When the substance or the subject matter is based on the law of those states. In other words, if prosecution is with respect of a federal offense in those state courts, if it's a federal offense,
yeah.
the Anti-Criminal Criminal Justice Act applies side by side the criminal procedure law of those states.
So at what point do you then distinguish?
If one
has superior provision, even though the state has provision, but one has another provision that is more progressive.
As far as a matter of procedural law, the law of the state will prevail. Okay. And this is the reason why...
And it's part of the challenges.
This is the reason we have been advocating. In fact, next week, we are hosting chief judges and attorneys general of 12 states. That's our Center for Social Legal Studies. You know, these are states that are yet to... Some of them have passed this law, but some are yet to pass the law. We are trying to build a kind of peer review mechanism whereby chief judges and attorneys general will come together, rub minds,
review each other.
Because the ideal situation is for us to have the Administration of Criminal Justice Law replicated in all states of the Federation.
That was the point I was going
that
to make.
That is the ideal
What would be the obstacle to that, for instance, if... Because I know that your job is not done yet on this law.
Absolutely.
Until it's of universal, I mean, when I say universal, I'm just nationwide application.
Yes.
What would be the obstacle standing in the path of every state, for instance, domesticating this law or having their own version of this law, just as we have the Child's Rights Act?
Yes.
Which many states
I understand that
the Child's Rights Act is even more problematic and more controversial.
I understand there are some cultural issues.
Because crime affects everybody.
I do not see any reason. By now, I thought every state house of assembly ought to have them.
Should be interested.
By now, you know, should be interested. And I know many are working on it. For example, the Speaker of the Kwara State House of Assembly, Dr. Ali Ahmad, you know, who played a leading role in the enactment of this law at the federal level. In fact, he sponsored the bill in the House of Representatives.
As a member then.
Now,
in the House.
As a speaker in the House of Assembly, he has already brought together all the speakers from all over the country and given them a model draft, a model for the southern states and a model for the northern states. And by now, it's a laudable contribution.
Yeah.
He did that with the support of the Justice for All and the UNODC. Okay. You know, so by now, I thought that most of the states...
Assemblies.
But of course,
that is if they know what they are doing.
Maybe there are challenges, and many are too busy chasing after money, and they have no time to deal with the critical issue of the day. Many are not thinking about legacy; they're just thinking about bread and butter. You know, but if we are going to change our country, everybody occupying one office or the other should be conscious of a sense of history. What am I going to be remembered by? What am I leaving behind? What will be told about me when I leave this office? People can be singing your praises now, But what will matter is what they say about you when you leave that office.
They are singing your praises now because you are still the source of their bread and butter.
Because you can give them bread
and
butter.
The moment another person becomes that source, you are forgotten.
You are forgotten, but your record should speak
for you. No matter the amount of bread.
Now we are speaking about what happened in Lagos State Ministry of Justice.
Yeah.
Let your record speak for you.
2007.
Since 1999.
Yeah. And the man is not even anywhere near there.
Absolutely.
People are still mentioning him as the architect of what is happening there. All right. One of the innovations of this law, which you just touched on, but you just mentioned it, is this monitoring committee.
Yes.
That's also novel. That the authors of this law, like Nostradamus, also saw the future. That, okay, we have this law, but how do we ensure that this spirit of the law lives forever and that people are made accountable to the process continuously? That's how I see this monitoring committee.
Yes.
Would you like to explain how this monitoring committee is working?
Thank you.
The composition first.
And incidentally, I was also made a member of the monitoring committee.
Because you are too important to this law
I wanted to just be discarded. Stay on the sideline
and watch
and assist the committee. But the chairman of the committee, Honorable Justice Ayu Bello, Ishak Bello, Chief Judge of Federal Capital Territory, who is the chairman of the Criminal Justice Monitoring Committee, said, during the inauguration, Professor, you can't leave us. You have to be part of this committee. Now, in fact, today, the committee is receiving a report. Mm-hmm. You know, the chief judge is receiving a report of a committee that he established to advise the monitoring committee about this work. The beautiful thing about the monitoring committee is that it has representatives of all the agencies of criminal justice system on it. The police is represented. The attorney general is represented. In fact, the attorney general appointed the secretary. You know, and the current secretary is Chief Okon Obla, you know, senior special advisor to the president on prosecution. He's the secretary to Administration of Criminal Justice Monitoring Committee.
Okay.
You know, and then we have representative of the police, Legal Aid Council, Human Rights Commission, Nigerian Prison, Federal High Court. So all of these are represented, and they are supposed to meet at least once per quarter to receive.
Quarter will mean 3 months or 4 months.
Four times a year. Oh. It could be three times a year or four times a year, depending on what you are looking at. Mm-hmm. You know, so the committee has started meeting. After its inauguration, it has started meeting. Now, a technical committee was set up to advise the committee. And this technical committee comprised of experts, you know, Professor Adedeji Adeku, a lot of people who have done a lot of work. They're advising the committee. You know, it is hoped that the committee, having taken off, you know, its impact will be felt, and then that should be reflected in the way things are done in our courts. But one thing that is urgent, and which must be done, as a matter of urgency, now that one has this opportunity, you know, one does not know who is listening. Mm. The criminal cases that are being tried now in the courts will not be concluded unless government moves swiftly to work with the judiciary to establish specialized divisions. I'm not talking about special courts. I'm talking about specialized divisions. Those specialized divisions will be equipped with witness systems, witness protection systems, prosecution systems, you know, such that witnesses are available for cases to proceed. So that the provision of this law relating to day-to-day trial, the situation whereby cases are adjourned for weeks, 4 weeks, it's a violation of the law. But we can understand, where are the witnesses? So we need a collaboration between the executive and the judiciary.
Okay.
And possibly, if there's need to allocate funding, if we think that corruption is a challenge we want to tackle as a country, we need to equip these agencies such that the specialized courts will be given a period of, I'm aware the FCT is also thinking of implementing something like that. Practice direction is issued so that cases can go on from day to day. So that those who have no case to answer can be released to go home.
Process through the system and released.
And those who have case to answer can be asked to, we'll quickly go through the system. But a situation where trials are adjourned, we start trials, I'm sure criminal justice implementation started almost 2 years now.
Yeah.
Most of the cases, of course, several
that
cases
started under this law.
Yes,
particularly those corruption cases.
Yes,
and I see here lawyers make application. Oh, I want to travel for medicals.
Absolutely.
Accused is making application. He wants to travel for medicals. Yeah. He wants the court to release his passport. Accused is still making. A defendant is still making application.
Yes,
that he has appealed a ruling denying him bail, so the trial should stop, and all of that. All of these things are things forbidden by this law.
Yeah. So that's why I said it's not the problem is not with the law. The problem is with the individuals who have one role or the other to play. I'm talking about
lawyers,
heads of courts, the executive,
the police.
You know, so there's need to put. I mean, it's like putting a new wine
in an old wine skin. It will burst.
That's exactly what has happened.
It will burst.
You have brought a new law, but the systems
the same
meant to operate that law remains the same. That's why we're not getting the results that we ought to get. Cases are still being adjourned. Witnesses are not available, you know, and we keep saying the courts are not doing their work. So unless all of these infrastructures are put in place, by the end of these four years of demonstration, the story will be the same, that not much has happened.
Do you have an idea how this funding issue should be resolved? I've already said the budgets for the judiciary this year has increased. Last year it was 80 billion.
Yes.
This year is 100 billion.
Yes.
That's what has been proposed.
We need a special funding for the justice system.
Okay.
A special provisioning, maybe presidential funding for the justice system.
Okay.
And what does that mean? Is to strengthen the investigators.
Okay.
You need a core of trained and professional investigators. You need to strengthen the capacity of prosecutors, you know? And then you need an effective witness system, protection system, you know.
System that will also compel them to be available.
Absolutely,
when they need them.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, tracking of cases, making sure that those on bail are available for their trial. Unless you do this, the whole purpose of this law may not be accomplished, may not be achieved.
If you do, I still have so much on this law to go, but time is usually not friendly with us on this program. Like with all the issues of
sentencing statistics
and all of that, this law has provided for alternative parole
alternatives
system,
to imprisonment,
community system,
non-custodial system, suspended sentence,
exactly,
you know, community service orders. So there's so much there. I'm happy you have read it. I'm delighted you have read it. It's not for lawyers alone.
It's not.
Yeah.
Prof, I'll find time to bring you again,
yes,
maybe in the nearest future. Maybe after all of these enlightenment things that are going on.
And this is very good, too,
thank
because
you.
A few
I'll
more
I'll
people
find time to bring you
will look,
again,
at, will look for the law.
I'll find time.
Yes, thank you.
All right. Florence Onodabero is saying, can the River State government, the environment agencies, and relevant authorities find the cause of this black suit in Port Harcourt? I've been getting a lot of complaints that the Port Harcourt skyline has been taken over by some very foul smell and all of that. Well, let's hope the Federal Minister of Environment is aware of all of that and ready to be on top of that. And we call it a day here, but we are not leaving you in a vacuum. The PDP review committee, which was set up not too long ago as part of efforts to reposition the umbrella party, has concluded its assignment, and they are presenting that report to the stakeholders in the PDP today. That event is about starting now, and that is where we'll be going to straight on now as I hand you over to our colleagues on location there at the PDP event. Thank you, Professor Yemi Akinseye George. I appreciate your time. My name is Greg Aulebar. See you tomorrow.